Colonel Peters, it's pretty extraordinary. I mean, if this reporting is correct, that the Secretary of Homeland Security was told not to bring up preventing further attacks on the United States to the President of the United States, essentially because his ego couldn't handle it, didn't want to hear about Russian interference.
Well, I think that's the standard line, that this is about 2016, about the legitimacy of his election. We're looking backward, but I believe that Donald Trump is looking forward to 2020. I mean, he can read the poll numbers. He's not doing well. His negatives are very, very powerful. And if the Democrats don't self-destruct, which they are perfectly capable of doing, he's going to be out of office in early 2021. And think what that means. If he doesn't win re-election, there's not just a new president, Anderson. There's a new attorney general. There's a new secretary of the Treasury, a new director of the IRS, perhaps a new director of the FBI. And once he is out of office, the senators can't help him, even if the Republicans maintain the majority in the Senate. He's going to be in the hands of the courts. And it does appear that there's going to be plenty to follow up. If he's not in prison, he'll be in the courts for years. So I really believe that Donald Trump is stonewalling on taking effective measures to prevent our electoral system because he wants Russian help. I think he'd take Chinese help. He'd take help from Albanian folk singers. He is desperate to win. And by the way, if he doesn't win in 2020, you're going to see the ugliest departure from the White House in American history.
So, what you're saying is that it's not just about ego. It's not just that any talk of Russian interference he hates because it, in his opinion, it questions the legitimacy of his victory. But you're saying he needs it or wants it to happen again to win.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, certainly his ego is always involved, and he wants 2016 to be seen as legitimate. But what matters to him is re-election, and it's becoming desperate. I believe he is afraid. For all his bluster and bravado, he's a terrified man. He knows the consequences if he loses in 2020. He knows because he knows far better than you and I know, far better than Robert Mueller knew, what his exposure is. What his criminal exposure is. Just today, documents are transferred from Deutsche Bank. This is going to go on for some time, and I genuinely believe that this is a president who does not care about this country. It's Trump first. It's not America first. It's make Trump greater, not make America great again. And I do believe he will do everything he can to prevent our government from stepping in and blocking Russian attempts to disrupt and influence the election.
When I've talked to Trump surrogates about this or people who support the president on this issue and say he's tougher on Russia than anybody else,
yes,
they always point to, well, look, the FBI is working on stopping Russian interference. Homeland Security is as well. The Secretary of State is as well. Does it matter if the president isn't holding cabinet-level meetings about this? Does it matter if the president doesn't want to hear about, is it ongoing? Does it make a difference if there was buy-in from the president on preventing this, full stop?
It makes a profound difference. If the president is excited about something, everybody gets excited about it. You need presidential leadership. You need the president to empower everyone from the Department of Homeland Security to the intelligence agencies to work together to do all they legally can to prevent and interfere with Russian attempts to disrupt the election. And to me, it is as clear as can be that Trump is sending the signal he doesn't want it to happen, and he continues to slow roll sanctions on Russia. I still will not criticize Vladimir Putin. I believe with the firmest conviction I could possibly communicate, that Trump will welcome the Russian help and any other help, but especially Russian help, in 2020. He is counting on them because he wants to win this election at any cost to our country.
Lastly, just a few hours ago, Kim Jong-un arrived in Russia for his first one-on-one meeting with Putin. I mean, I wonder if they have a conversation about President Trump. And I can only imagine what that conversation would be like.
Well, I think there'd be some laughter. I mean, Kim is clearly dating around. But Putin has manipulated Trump brilliantly. Kim Jong-un got much of what he wanted, and Trump got nothing in return. And that's Trump's flabbergasting incompetence is yet another issue. But I always come back to the Russia issue. And, you know, if you think back, if you want to look back at 2016 and that statement, when he stood up and said, Russia, if you're listening, I mean, it's as if in 1940, FDR had said, Berlin, if you're listening, we need help. Putin is our enemy because he has chosen to be our enemy. He is an inveterate enemy. He wants the United States damaged badly, if not destroyed. He is gleefully disrupting everything he can. And our president is his accessory and assistant.
I do want to ask you one last question, though. Yesterday I talked to Paul Krugman on the program, and one of the things he had written and he talked about last night in the program was saying that he believes we may not have a functioning democracy in 2020 if the president wins again. Essentially, America as we know it is under threat. And one of the things I asked him, you know, he said, if you're not scared, you're not paying attention.
Well, I don't think you're going to have to wait to see some of Trump's maliciousness. He's already doing tremendous damage, abetted, by the way, by the Senate Republicans, who are amazingly undercutting their own institution and its powers for very short-term gain. But Trump, yes, if Trump wins, he'll do great damage. But if he loses the election, he is going to call upon his supporters for violence. There's not going to be a civil war. That's idiocy. But you will see at least isolated violence on the part of crackpot supporters. He will be clinging to the doors of the White House, giving orders to everybody on all sides that the honest people will not obey, the career employees will not obey, the military certainly won't obey. Anderson, you know, let's check back in a couple of years, but I'm telling you, and it's not funny, it's going to be very, very ugly, whatever happens, but Trump needs to go for the good of this country.
And the silence of Republicans in Capitol Hill is extraordinary. I mean, the Republican Party that I knew growing up, you know, the party of Reagan, the party of, I mean, that's just, it's just a dim memory.
Yeah, I mean, in national level elections as an adult, I've voted for Republicans probably two times out of three. They don't exist anymore. That party is gone. These people are so incredibly craven. And this was the party of patriots. They were going to defend the American Alamo to the last round.
And the Constitution. I mean, that was everything.
Oh, forget the Constitution. They're shredding it. I mean, again, the constitutional crisis is right now with the Republicans in Congress preventing Congress, doing their best to prevent Congress from fulfilling its duty of being a check and balance on the president. And they also allow this president, who has already gone rogue, it's not a question of will he go rogue, he is daily damaging our country at home and abroad. And Anderson, you know, I don't get a buzz off being on TV. The reason I'm here is because I believe deeply we have to speak out. When Trump's gone, I'm gone. Sooner is better than later.
Colonel Peters, I appreciate being here with us tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.